Hello everybody, I'm Kai, and this is my talk here for open source vendor for DJI laptops and servers. And looking back at now, this is an absolutely terrible title. And let's fix that and make it a bit more shorter and say, okay, what we want is a free open source laptop, right? It has to be able to be accessible, practical, and affordable. But before I tell you how to get this, you get to suffer through more information. So I'm very short about myself. So I'm a co-founder of Neo, we do firmware-based security user authentication. I also wear many hats, and I'm also a member and founder of the Open Source Firmware Foundation. And Open Source Firmware is a security leader, and we try to push Open Source Firmware in the general systems we have, right? And Intel-based laptops and servers. So we're trying to push COVID, for example, and allow you guys to get systems that have open firmware on. Okay, so firmware. How to find this firmware? So the PC firmware is always known as the BIOS, right? So this is a picture of the original IBM 5150 mainboard. The thing contains a lot of chips. One of them is at position 233, is the BIOS chip. At that time, BIOS was actually a set of routines the operating system, in this case, this would be Microsoft and DOS, would call to do stuff like print stuff to the screen, and then talk to the disk controller and stuff like that. So it was kind of an operating system itself. Nowadays, these things look a bit more like that, right? We have some weird text-based interface where you can configure some settings, where you see what, how much memory you have. The older one, like the old school one, now we have a better laptop like this here and already put. They have some nice graphical user interfaces, they have nice signal, but they're still kind of hard to use, right? You know, that's how it says nobody understands. What we want from our company from our buyers is, first of all, the thing goes on, right? And I don't care about all that stuff. When you turn that thing on here, your CPU is powered on, and that starts in a 16-bit revolt that is compatible to Microsoft MS-DOS. So you can run your MS-DOS pretty much unmodified on your latest SP Xeon system powered yesterday. When it's installing this mistake, you have to get a lot of the 16-bit mode, get into something more technical, and you also have to do a RAM, which is quite a problem. So when you start the system up, unlike the original IBM PC, you don't have a DRAM. So the DRAM controller there has to be trained so that the link to the actual disk drives have to be trained. So before you even start doing stuff, you have to basically the caches, the internal caches that are the SRAM that's on chip, and you can misuse them as well. But before we even do that, we will have to send a standard code to page configure that, right? Because the little code we have, it will be seen, it will go up at the first instruction. Right? If you have a program, you can't have a stack, for example, right? So we have to, when the assembly is start, we configure our caches well, then C goes on, and we configure the DRAM and so on. Here is the first few example of what files we could have, right? So we can have an EDK tool, and this is the modern version of the BIOS called the VFI, which is a system that follows the VFI standard. You get two in this case. And we have a more. There's also Kobo, yes. And we have a more traditional system like Kobo, which doesn't have VFI capabilities. But the problem is they both have the same stuff, right? They all need a different. Basically, the first thing is that the FI station has something called the driver execution environment. It sounds awful like an operating system, right? So this is because there is one. So when we, again, look back at the IBM PC, everything can go home for IBM and some third-party vendors, and they put the cars together, that's it. But, in reality, the supply chain for a system looks nowadays is that you have the SoC vendors, right, the chip vendors on top. You have to use some reference code to get the system running, for example, during the run training. They saw that this is constrained and from Bios, vendors that built the Bios, right, they take this reference code, which is mostly free, and the open source reference code that's from the Tiano Core project, and combine it with their own proprietary stuff to produce in Bios, or at least like a framework for Bios. The next thing consumed by the OEMs, but people and companies like China and Taiwan with both these things actually have there. Foxconn is really most well known, they write the iPhones and go to different things. And these companies don't sell it to download or also their green package that put their logo on and sell to you. Because if it's similar fact here, because for example, you know, that's part of them, but also Dell puts their own like functionality device. In order to do that, right, you have to add stuff to the BIOS at every step. Right? You have the reference code, you have the proprietary features, codes, the building codes here, from AI and so on, and you have like, the additional features from Dell. And you have to put it all together. And in order to put it all together, you need some kind of standard. And this is what the UFI is. Right? And this is the first abuse, and the UFI is actually free. So it's open source. Yeah, it's mostly these design servants. There are some parts in there that are open source. For different drivers, there are some free ones. But it's mostly free, right? And this is like a reference implementation that is the basis of all the reference that run in the systems. So there's all the parts of the open source. But you have things like the virtual machine, you also have some kind of firmware there, because if you move from some goodness, the virtual machine expects some kind of UEFI interface. And this is pretty much complete your software. You just take Tiano Core, compile that, put it into the you have it there. The Tiano Core project is kind of like these corporate sponsored open source projects, right? It's directly open, but everybody who works in there is an employer or a company that was told by it to contribute that. Nowadays, there are lots of people are coming in there, but it's still very corporate sponsored, which means that as a single developer, getting the code by accepted really difficult. And you have situations where they just dump a bunch of pull requests onto GitHub. If you don't know where this comes from, very well discussed, like some really open process here. But you can watch at least the development. And so it's on GitHub, right? You can go to GitHub. If you actually want to have it, I would recommend you try the Tiano Core EBK2 platforms, which is part of the EBK plus the platforms code, meaning the code that we actually need to run it on actual hardware. Actually, hardware to buy, like, for example, the new bottlenecks. But you can take this and put it and play it on thing, and it will work, presumably. I haven't tried it yet. But this is one of the options. The more popular one, and the more well known one, is CoreBoot. So CoreBoot is not a UEFI, it's partly because it predicts UEFI, we understand it, partly because CoreBoot has a different approach. The idea of CoreBoot is we do only as much as necessary as to build Linux, and no more, right? With the UEFI, for example, UEFI has some drives in there, for example, if you want to get the boot from UEFI, you have to have a network stack in there, but you have to have drives to talk to your network card. If you want to boot from the disk, right, you have to have disk drives in there, you have to understand file systems. You don't need that, you can just boot Linux. This other is that CoreBoot is not only open source, it's also free software, that's GPL2 license, everything is there. It's all about repository, right, you don't have like this separate project with like the UEFI system. Development process is an actual open process, right? So you can participate as a single developer. There are lots of people in the CoreBoot project that are just hobbyist developers that are not employed by any company. They contribute code. The only hobby here is that there are nothing happens with Garrett, which is a group endorsed review program, and you have to live with that. But if you do that, you can contribute. I did so. So, maybe short, what does that mean in the code case, yeah? So, things like the UEFI boot process simplified. So, time goes from the left to right, and the yellow boxes are like face. And the red is what actually happens. So we start off with some verification phase. We have to actively chip some ball in it, or jump ball in the RAM. And then we have driver phase. We have a bunch of drivers. So we have this TXE, which is pretty much a driver package that we see here standard. And these drivers can reference other drivers, right? For example, if you have the network boot driver, we reference the TCP stack driver, which in turn reference like the network stack driver, the network card driver, and so on. So these drivers are all loaded, and there will be this dependency tree, and maybe solve the runtime. So this takes quite a while. That's why these servers, for example, they take ages to boot. Then we have to merge, right? We take all this driver functionality, and we actually figure out, okay, what to boot next. You can actually have multiple boot applications there that are loaded after each other. So maybe one is loaded and does an update, and the other one is loaded to figure out, okay, what should be next, and so on. But finally, after all this work, we finally go to the graph and graph those winners and add it up. And all this stuff is mostly erased except for the runtime services that we make in memory. So even after the system has printed, we still have to see that by stuff hiding out in the RAM because it still needs these runtime services, for example, to set configurations in the airport. If you recall it, we just take away that. But we just have to initial the problem that is on the code. We do the RAM inspection, the RAM stage, and just like to drop the memory trigger. And then we execute the payload. The payload can be pretty much anything you want, but there's only one. Right? There's not a bunch of manager applications or whatever. You have only one payload, and most of the things are done. And the whole thing is laid down. Right? There are a lot of things like that. You just put a system. But then tell me, Kai, what will happen in that book? What if I want to have complicated features? Well, some people want that. But what if I want to make this graph user as they can configure stuff? In order to be working, like I said, we need some kind of operating system, right? But instead of writing on a new operating system, purpose built just to do booting, why not use one we already have? Called Linux, right? There are many drivers for whatever you want in the RAM. The drivers are well better engineered than the stuff you have in the RAM, right? They are more secure, right? They are more secure than the code in the Linux. Figuring out what is good, right? Development is very effective. So just use that. Easy. When you use Linux boot, right? The idea is just to take Linux, the user space. This can be used huge, which is a Go program that allows you to package your singular Go application as you already, and it provides a bunch of libraries for building. For example, they can parse block configs and so on, so you can load pretty much the same code that the block would do, but without using actually block and stuff like that. But we package it all, we put it on the flash with the code root, and then we call it Linux with just the code root, just as the English language, just as much as the process necessary to do it. For example, we don't need to enumerate the PCI bus in our code root, like the web address. Because the first thing that Linux does after you start it is you know, you use PCI bus to enable it less, but you don't have to do this in the box already. We should have planned to use it anyways. So it doesn't have a minimum resolution, which means we pay off the board, we bring the CPU and we bring the 64-bit node, we enable one, obviously. And then we come to Linux, and Linux can use an online system, or can be used from you, for example, to write a Google application. And suddenly you can do things you want, right? You can write your own network boot system, for example, you don't have to use TFTP. Use HTTP or something more interesting, like the big chart, to put your OS package for the network. You need to have the graphic user interface, right? You could, instead of having these terrible text interfaces, you could package a Chrome browser, right? You can have the XR in there or whatnot, and have your graphic user interface done with your background or whatnot. So, maybe one case was one example that you can do with that. When you use Linux, you can build some type of system transparency. So the basic idea here is system transparency is just an effort paper that will pull the new OS package off the network, measure that, meaning it will hash the actual package, and put this into a special hardware security chip that can later query that, and encrypt it, right? Which means that I, as a user of the server, right, I can connect to the server. The server will give me the signed version of this hash where it has been created at runtime, and send it to me. And then I can figure out, okay, is this hash value the same that I would expect in this OS package, right? So I can check the OS package and verify the hash and can say, okay, this has been actually booted on the system, right? So reliable people that tell me, I don't worry, this is the boot, this is also boot here. The point of view is, this is a big one, right? And we don't actually write much code. We actually don't have to even write C code. It's just a bunch of, it's a bit of code on the rest of the and everything else is just easy, right? Because it's a normal system, it's a Linux, it's in the flash, and we have to do now the Linux series specification to use all drivers. This makes stuff like this pretty easy, right? And this is just one example of what we can do. So, yes, so we short while we don't, but then there's so much open source from x86. The problem is actually not like the Windows and media is the virus spike chip we're thinking about. This stuff is pretty much over, right? We know how to do that with them. I'm not going to stop you from reading anything. I'm a good guy, right? There are lots of open source, just trying to assist that happened and make it. Provides aftermarket, but it doesn't prevent you to put any open things in there. What actually happened in here is that we have to borrow now we have the information we need to do our NDA and all of this like virus development runs very device specific, right? You have to have some of the more layouts to figure out okay, how do you configure or how to set up certain ACP items and stuff like that. And yeah, simply that of course you mentioned, right? To put the IBD in a virus vendor doesn't know what code we okay, so but what we have an open source laptop, right? And we want it to be accessible, practical, and affordable, right? And this is where the anti-RISC-V comes in. Accessible means we're not going to flash anything, right? We're not going to buy a ThinkPad and take it apart and put it so it's good file with a bunch of wires to it to flash code content. Right? This is not accessible. We're also not going to buy an now 10-year-old ThinkPad, it's an X230. You can buy them with Kobe, or in this case, maybe which is a print and fork of Kobe. This is an iWatch system. You can do the self-development though. I have one of them, they're nice, right? This is not really practical system anymore, especially if you want to use like more stuff like Chrome browser, for example. Other ones seems to be affordable. So there are companies that do sell you on a desktop with the port 410, which is the latest iteration of IBM's port PC architecture, that's their life. The thing runs 100% on open source firmware, cost actually more than the two different networks. So the only problem is that for example, go to buy just a Chrome. All Chromebooks that built after 2018, they are not coupled. There are 100% open source firmware. Google Overlook develops all that stuff upstream, so you can just fork the code, get the code, compile it. Depending on the device, you have to disable some kind of security protection, or so you can just, the browser can just write it into your flash chip. There are some write protection there, you can maybe disassemble the system. Maybe press the reload button combination, but then it's unlocked and you can flash your own firmware. Or if you don't like ColorOS, you can just get one of these. So you can have one for 6.6, they sell you a normal laptop, one ColorBoot, sell it to a certain custom. These are actually pretty affordable, around the 1K range. The even cheaper ones are a little higher than tourism, I think. But all these, they're uncovered, right? Open source firmware, and I have a lot of upstream, so you can even put the whole version of the code and throw it on there. And for servers, it's actually pretty easy. You can just go to the open compute project. There are industry consortiums, which are initially started by Facebook. Nowadays, they have way more companies in there. This is the so-called OCP is gigantic. They have specifications for all kinds of things and stuff. But one of them is a service, and the one of the servers are the open system player. And the open system player says pretty much, okay, what kind of firmware do we say okay is open? You have to read the fine print here a bit because there are a bit more vendor friendly because it means that they will allow a firmware that is maybe created out of open source code, but they don't distribute the actual code, right? They only have the boundary and the promise that it is open. This doesn't apply to every vendor, of course, but like I said, read the fine print. But ultimately, all the systems that have this OCP is set to accept the batch. Will likely run open source firmware. And two examples of them are the DSP OCP service and the TR with the material class from William. The DSP are, as far as I know, like the latest greatest sample records SP systems. And they are standard like 90-inch systems you can put into your record. TR was a bit more specialized, they are more like 8-center type thing where you can have some high density and whatever, just they download it into Xeon systems. They are not fun, but they are also fun in the code. And we actually have done all that, they are super fun. So, takeaways. Also, firmware is obviously in the future. Nobody sells operating systems anymore. I'm not sure if you figure out it, but pretty much nobody sells it anymore. Nobody makes money selling compilers anymore, right? Or text editors. And this is really the same thing in less than a decade for firmware, right? Nobody will sell you an appliance anymore, you can just get an open source virus, one way, change it a bit, and then put it onto your hardware. You can get a modern, workable, affordable system running open source firmware pretty easy. Just off the shelf, you don't disable the system, you don't have to flash anything. You just buy one, like I said, in a firmware or six system or one more custom. If you're interested in, but I always had an idea about, hey, I want to bring something with the boot system, but I have this nice idea. I want to, for example, a new installer in my firmware, right? Instead of, I think my system doesn't have an operating system installed. Instead of saying, well, I can boot, maybe the firmware probably comes with an installer, we pull the ISO from, whatever. Of the network, and this is very friendly, right? Some of this can be implemented super easy, but now that you have USB, because you don't have to know Linux, right? You can write the application with Fedora and Python. You have to know the Linux user space there, all the drivers and everything. So if you want to get creative, now's the time. And with that, I say thank you, and any questions?